on this edition of In the Life.
Lesbians, that's right.
A house in Iowa and a house in Washington.
As an American, how do I feel? I never thought we'd be here now.
Please say
from the pulpit.
Now, my brothers and my sisters.
To the podium. Lemony. All as American as apple pie.
Ow!
Next on In the Life, America's information line on gay and lesbian issues and culture. In the Life is funded in part by the H. Van Ameringen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Gill Foundation, the Michael Palm Foundation, the Snowden Foundation, Richard M. and Peggy Danziger, Jeffrey B. Soriff, the Mitchell Gold Company, in the hopes of eliminating all types of fear and prejudice, the Nebraska AIDS Project, and In the Life members like you.
Life and Independence Hall in Philadelphia. Hi, I'm Katherine Linton. We call this program our American is Apple Pie episode because in it we highlight how gay men and lesbians share the same hopes, aspirations, and values as other Americans and are working for their share of the proverbial pie. For 30 years, gay people have taken their battles to the streets and the courts in an effort to gain basic legal protections and civil rights. But they also want to be full participants in every segment of American society, even her most conservative institutions. Of course, the gay community has made strides. This was evident last fall when President Clinton addressed the Human Rights Campaign Dinner. It was a historic moment, not only because he was the first sitting president to address a gay organization, but because he put forth the idea that gay people should share the same rights as all Americans.
So I think one of the greatest things we have to do still is just to increase the ability of Americans who do not yet know that gays and lesbians are their fellow Americans in every sense of the word to feel that way.
But while gay men and lesbians may be American citizens, they have not been granted the full rights of citizenship. In this first segment, we'll take a look at how gay people are increasingly demanding, and in some cases winning, access to America's traditional institutions. From the military to the family, even the Boy Scouts, we'll document the progress that has been made and the long road yet to travel.
They sent me back another certified letter saying no nor valid homosexuals are not permitted in the Boy Scouts of America. When I got that, my heart kind of sank.
We are married in our own eyes, but we'd like to have that marriage legalized and we'd like to enjoy the same rights that every other married couple has.
You know, people who take the same oath to serve our country, put their lives on the line for our country, and perform the same responsibilities should be treated the same.
The mere fact that you're gay means you lose custody, or the mere fact that you're gay means you're deemed unfit.
Gay and lesbian people should be just as entitled to make diverse choices, to join any institution, to serve in any capacity, to serve their country, to get married, to be in the Boy Scouts, or for that matter, to choose not to do so, as any other person.
One sacred notion of American liberty is the right to privacy, a right largely won by gay adults in the majority of states, with the help of gay legal organizations like the 25-year-old Lambda Legal Defense and Education Fund.
When Lambda got started, consensual sexual relations between people of the same gender was illegal in 49 states. We were listed in the psychiatric handbook as having a mental disorder. Political figures, by and large, wouldn't meet with us, let alone support us. So the difference between then and now is a sea change.
But there are still 20 states with sodomy laws on the books. Five specifically targeting sex between same-gender partners. And the worst defeat for gay people's right to privacy came in 1986 with the Supreme Court's decision in Bowers versus Hardwick. The decision that Georgia's sodomy law did not violate plaintiff Michael Hardwick's rights.
Mm-hmm.
Most Americans assume they have the right to rent an apartment, organize a club, or hold a job. The right to equal protection under the law. But accountant Daniel Miller found out otherwise when his boss fired him for being gay. When Miller later brought former clients to his own business, the legal battle began.
He sued me. And not only was I fired and discriminated against blatantly because I'm gay, I was also then sued by my former employer.
He's really an example of somebody who paid pretty dearly for the lack of protection.
Employment, housing, public accommodation, and credit are key, and in only 10 states do we have those things. I mean, that's unbelievable, 25 or 30 years into our movement as we know it.
While the movement has suffered setbacks, one major victory was the 1996 Supreme Court decision declaring Colorado's Amendment 2 unconstitutional, signaling that the nation's highest court would not tolerate laws that discriminate against homosexuals. This marked a turning point for the gay movement, from a focus on legal protections to demands for full access to some of America's most cherished institutions.
Under Don't Ask, Don't Tell, Don't Pursue, President Clinton has fired more gay people than any corporation or collection of corporations in America. That goes to the heart of whether we can be citizens. The military is the largest employer in our nation. The military socializes more young people than any other institution aside from the public schools. And when the military sends a message that gay people are second-class citizens, That message is picked up and interpreted by society at large.
Any message about second-class citizenship is deeply felt in the social unit most dear and sacred to many Americans, the family. For the gay movement, family issues have also become a new battleground.
So we first start with fighting for family recognition. And then the kinds of responsibilities and freedoms that other people take for granted. Domestic partner benefits, the opportunity to visit a loved one who's sick and in the hospital, or to assist in funeral planning, or visit in a prison. Healthcare benefits, or being able to go to a gym, or a tuition credit. The freedom to marry, the opportunity to adopt children when it's in their best interest, to maintain custody of the children that we have.
But gains in marriage and parental rights imply not just social tolerance, but society's moral approval. That's where gay rights opponents draw the line.
It is a sickness. Homosexuality is an abomination.
God hates homosexuality.
Sure was a private life when she was hugging and kissing in that homosexual parade a year ago in San Francisco.
So we see legislators really running amok, and largely it's because it's a good fundraising issue for the right. They're raising money off the backs of our family. They understand that we're going to win the same gender marriage case in Hawaii, and they're afraid of it.
As of now, roughly around 28 states have passed one kind or another of anti-marriage law, not only preventing us from getting married, but declaring that once we are legally married somewhere, our marriage will become an unmarriage if we cross the wrong state border. Obviously, we think this is unconstitutional.
We want our relationship to be recognized the same way that other people's relationships are recognized.
Our society decides to exclude us from these institutions that are given a great amount of social weight, and therefore there's huge meaning to being excluded from those institutions. And even though we might wish to say we don't fight to be included in that institution because we don't believe it's a meritorious institution, the truth is that that gets read from the other side as you don't even believe you deserve inclusion in this institution.
Finally, when the all-American institution called the Boy Scouts sought to exclude gays on moral grounds, one state Supreme Court said no.
I remained in the program until I was 19 years old, when I was dismissed for being gay. They taught you to stand up for what you believe in, to be a leader, to be honest, to be trustworthy. All the things they taught me said what I was doing was the right thing.
Dale sued the Boy Scouts over his dismissal.
I couldn't handle the contradiction and the hypocrisy of it all. So I said that, I'm not going to allow this to happen.
This is a case about homosexuals and their rights to privacy, equal protection, and due process.
The Boy Scout conflict goes to the heart of the debate in the courts over moral acceptance of lesbians and gays, and times seem to be changing. Here's what the New Jersey Supreme Court judges said in their March ruling against the Boy Scouts. Nothing before us even suggests that a male, simply because he is gay, will somehow undermine Boy Scouts of America's fundamental beliefs and teachings. These stereotypical notions of homosexuals must be rejected.
It was really a decision handed down that was very strongly worded, saying basically that we are equal people and we deserve equal protection.
We're not asking for just to be able to get on the bus, but thanks, we'll sit on the back. We're saying we want full equality.
And it's going to mean changing laws, it's going to mean changing attitudes, and it's going to mean changing ourselves in ways that I don't even think we understand today.
Clearly, the fight for gay rights in America goes on, a battle that is all too familiar to political veteran Virginia Apuzzo, a woman whose life in many ways reflects the gay rights movement. A nun in 1969, Apuzzo was transformed by the Stonewall Rebellion, whereupon she left the convent to pursue political activism and public service. For 30 years, one of the movement's most visible activists, she's now the highest-ranking openly gay official in government. We bring you now a day in the life of Virginia Apuzzo, the woman who was once arrested in front of the White House and is now running it.
So why don't we go around the table and just do our thing. Okay, so Brooks, what do we have?
Yesterday I distributed the monthly parking permits.
As assistant to the president, Apuzzo is responsible for the smooth running of all White House functions, from the daily operations.
Room 1 actually just prepared a draft package of I'm new to the complex or I'm moving that will help.
To Clinton's recent trip to Africa.
As we walked through the village, we looked at the various little businesses. And
25 years ago, would you have ever imagined yourself here?
No, I didn't imagine myself here 25 weeks ago. No, this is I don't think you begin as a out gay person in government thinking that someday you'll end up at the White House.
As a gay person myself, I would have never imagined an out lesbian in the White House. How do people react? I mean, are people...
Well, most people say a lesbian ex-nun in the White House. that's the issue for them.
And yet Apuzzo has successfully combined a long career in government with her gay rights activism. In 1976 and 1980, she coordinated the National Gay Task Force efforts to get a plank in the Democratic Party platform.
By the time it got to be 1980, there was a foundation for some of the work to be done. There was the threat of Reagan defeating Carter. The Democratic Party finally saw that we were not just an issue that was embarrassing candidate Carter, but a constituency that was pivotal if President Carter was to prevail. After that, I supported Governor Cuomo's run for the governor, and at that time was very tempted to join his administration. He had made it known that I would be welcome in the administration, and just at that time, I was asked to take on the role of executive director of the National Gay Task Force. Then the movement exploded in the 80s, and I was there and privileged to serve during those times.
Apuzzo got her chance to work for Governor Cuomo in 1985 on the Consumer Protection Board, where she continued her work on the emerging AIDS issues.
I'd been doing advocacy work at Consumer Protection around the cost of AIDS drugs, as well as everything from morticians who wouldn't take corpses. People couldn't have their loved ones provided a funeral, despite their willingness to pay and everything. They just, you know, we had to fight every step of the way.
So when activists planned a protest against President Reagan's AIDS policies, Apuzzo wanted to be there.
I'd been there locally in New York, and I'd been there lobbying Congress for the first hearings on AIDS. We'd been to the FDA, and now there was a protest at the White House, but I was a government official. So I did it, and I was arrested, and it was one of my proudest moments to be able to cross a line and have it mean that, okay, you know, we're willing to go up against and beyond the law to say this is wrong. Fortunately, I was a government official in Mario Cuomo's administration, and Mario Cuomo is the kind of person who understands when an issue is a matter of conscience.
This is a shot during a press conference with Governor Cuomo, and I love the shot because it's very clear that Mario Cuomo is actually listening. Now, usually Mario Cuomo is talking and pointing. In this picture, I'm pointing and talking, and Mario Cuomo is listening. So I kind of like that picture.
Her arrest was not a problem for Clinton either. Now, as assistant to the president, her days are filled with meetings.
Work before work and work after work, but the day generally is filled from 7:45 in the morning until 6-7 o'clock at night with meetings. One meeting after another.
And she uses her role to continue to raise the issues of gay and lesbian civil rights.
As managers, are we ready for what diversity really, you know, needs to mean in the 21st century? And is the institution prepared, once people are here, to provide what is needed? And I talk only from my own experience. As a lesbian, is the government prepared for spousal benefits?
Do I have an opportunity to say this is important? Yeah. I mean, take the fact that the president went a couple of months ago to the Human Rights Campaign dinner. I had the opportunity to drive over with the president and to talk to him about issues of concern to gays and lesbians, and was delighted to see that, you know, the president was there. I said, you know, look, a lot of people have emailed me and said, this is a very important thing you're doing. And, you know, the president said, I'm happy to be doing it. It's the right thing to do. And do I have an abiding astonishment over the fact every night when I walk out and see the White House? Yeah. I grew up in the 40s and 50s in the Bronx. You know, I've been called every name under the book in my life, you know, dyke. And from there, from people who never said it with love and caring. I've been an outlaw in 22 states, you know. Lesbians and gays are felons in 22 states in this country. Am I pleased? I'm delighted. As an American, how do I feel? I never thought we'd be here now, but I know that the vision for the administration is to keep moving forward, and so I've got my eye on where we can go.
From America's political center to its entertainment center, Hollywood, our next segment takes us inside an amazingly successful multimedia production company started by Fenton Bailey and Randy Barbato. As correspondent Bill Britt explores this wonderfully wacky world, we're reminded that there's nothing more American than a capitalist spirit and the art of packaging.
The Crossroads Complex here in Los Angeles is the home of World of Wonder, where Bailey and Barbato have made big business out of high camp. From managing the career of America's favorite cross-dressing queen to creating daring documentaries, World of Wonder has managed to filter underground pop culture through a gay sensibility and market it to the mainstream.
I've tried a few kinky things.
To me, coming to America.
Tonight we salute lesbians.
He has a vagina. No one in there.
Do not attempt to adjust your television sets. What you are seeing is really on the air. Brought to you by World of Wonder partners Randy Barbato and Fenton Bailey, who are more than just business partners.
We have been together as a couple for...
back in the day when couples were couples.
What, 16 years.
The key, the success to our business and
our relationship in general is that we have an office in Los Angeles and we have an office in London.
And I'm going there right now.
Pack your bags. You guys don't know where
he's at? As managers of the career of RuPaul, executive producers of the RuPaul show on VH1, and documentary and series producers for a slew of shows for HBO, BBC, and Channel 4 UK, Randy and Fenton are busy men. They're bonded together not only by their devotion to each other, but by their devotion to pop culture.
I think Randy and I found that we had similar sensibilities in that we like very camp things, we like quite tasteless things, or things that would push the envelope. I suppose that the problem is that oftentimes people think that pop culture is some kind of bland mush, and that for people to buy it en masse, it's got to be appeal to everybody, and therefore it can't be edgy, different, or it can't be BED, you know, bold, edgy, daring. In fact, it seems really that people want different, edgy, daring stuff. So why else would you bother with pop culture? And so we've always felt that things that people have traditionally dismissed as marginal are in fact potentially mainstream. You don't turn on the television, I don't think, to see your own life reflected back at you. You turn on the television as a kind of window on the world to see other situations, other lives, because you're curious.
In their documentary for HBO entitled Drop Dead Gorgeous, Randy and Fenton give us a funny yet disturbing peek into the life of Steve Moore, an HIV-positive comedian.
I come home for Christmas 2 years ago, right? And my mom, Wilma, buys me a cemetery plot. I'm not kidding. Isn't that sweet? And the saddest thing, it's the only piece of land I've ever owned. Well, we paid $600 for it. Thing is, I come home for Christmas last year, and my mom doesn't give me anything. And I said, hey, Wilma, what's up with that? Well, hell, you didn't use what we gave you last year.
Like many gays and lesbians in the media, Randy and Fenton sometimes struggle to balance their sexual orientation and their professional choices.
I always thought that, always took the line that sexuality was secondary to who you are. And I have to say, as I get sort of older and uglier, I realize that's really not acceptable, and that in fact, being gay is very much who I am, and it kind of colors every single fiber of my being and every kind of choice I make and every moment of my day. And so, I've definitely changed my opinion about that, and I think in making this documentary about Ellen, the real Ellen story, it's had a profound personal effect.
This is the real Ellen story, about a television event not measured by ratings, but by one woman's desire to tell the truth.
I didn't realize how many people were affected by what she did, and all the hundreds, probably thousands of people who themselves came out because of her singular courage. And I found it to be very, very moving.
I'm not trying to change anybody's opinion on anything other than to say that I'm fine with who I am now. And for a long time, I wasn't.
I think everybody out there wants stuff that they don't normally get. And they want stuff that is real. And so whether we're motivated by something because it's, I mean, we're really motivated not just by stuff that's gay. People like, you know, Ellen DeGeneres and Steve Moore and RuPaul, these are people who are more than gay or lesbian. These are people who listen to what's true to themselves, fight for it, and they create great product. And I think the audience for that is everyone and anyone.
Well, you know, you've heard of that thing of how drag queens get their names.
Oh, the formula.
The formula.
Yeah.
What is it? It goes, the first name.
Family pet. Because
your
not
first
everybody
family
has a dog.
Pet.
Right.
Your first family pet.
And the mother's maiden name.
And the mother's maiden. That would make my name Pookie Fontanette.
That's hot.
Yes.
That's hot. So it's your first.
We never thought we'd be doing so many overtly gay projects. The Real Ellen Story, Drop Dead Gorgeous, Steve Moore, I guess even Party Monster. RuPaul. I mean, we had no idea that it would turn out this way, and I'm so glad it did, actually. Lifting you up to a brighter day, a little bit of love goes a long, long way. Oh, yeah,
decades ago, images of gay men and lesbians were nearly invisible, much less marketable. But the 1970s, following on the heels of the 1969 Stonewall Rebellion, were a time when many gay Americans came alive politically. During those years, a photographer named Jeb and a recording company called Olivia Records saw the awakening of lesbian ideas and identity and knew it was the stuff of history. In our next segment, we take you back in time through snapshots and sounds with two of the most important chroniclers of the early lesbian feminist movement.
I was always most interested in photographing within the communities of which I was a part, and primarily that was the lesbian community, the feminist community, the progressive community, working in anti-war and anti-nuclear issues.
Jeb is a Washington, D.C.-based artist who has been taking pictures since 1971.
My work has always been about making the invisible visible, and because lesbians were so invisible, they were always my first subject of choice, and of course, nearest to my heart.
In 1979, Jeb broke new ground in lesbian visibility with the publication of her book, Eye to Eye, Portraits of Lesbians.
Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender people need to be represented in all our diversity, and that in itself is an activist statement.
Her second book, Making a Way, Lesbians Out Front, features the leaders, artists, and everyday heroes of the lesbian community. Since her photo documentary of the 1987 March on Washington was transferred to videotape and broadcast on public television, she now prefers to work in video.
I decided to become a video maker because the pictures wanted to talk.
Jeb's photos, mementos, and videos were gathered for a retrospective of her work, which inaugurated George Washington University's Gay and Lesbian History Project.
Things changed. Things really changed. And I'm, like, very proud of that, being part of that change.
While photography served to document the 70s wave of lesbian feminism, there was also music.
What happened in the 70s was that women came into their own and came into their own sense of sexuality, their own sense of culture, their own sense of liberation and independence. If the collective unconscious had erupted and suddenly the music was sort of a focal point for women throughout the country. We started Olivia in 1973, and it was a group of 10 lesbian feminists.
First goal of Olivia Records is to get the music out. Second goal of Olivia Records.
Music. What music?
Women's music. Ah. High quality women's music. Women's music that speaks honestly and realistically to women about women's lives, to women's lives.
By the end of 1975 and the beginning of 1976, well, the concerts went from 50 and 100 people to thousands of people all across the country. In the fall of 1975, we released our second album, which was our best-selling album ever, which was The Changer and the Changed. Just won't let me be a passive time till I hold you and you. Changer and the Changed charted on the Billboard charts. There was a response to the music that was unheard of in independent music. When we started Olivia, we used the term women's music very, quite on purpose, because number one, it was too scary a time to just start out with something that said lesbian.
God puts it in the same category as murderers, thieves, prostitution,
And if we give special privileges to homosexuals, then we have to give it to the murderer, to the thief, and to the prostitute.
When we made our, I think it was our fifth album, it was in reaction to Anita Bryant, and it was called Lesbian Concentrate. What we were saying when we made Lesbian Concentrate was that we were also a political entity. And it was the first time that many of these women had come out and said, I am a lesbian, and this was in 1977. We developed an independent industry where we created the producers to produce concerts. We created the distributors to get the records into the stores and grew an audience so that when the industry was really interested, there was already a market ready for the music. You know, you go to a Melissa Etheridge concert and the percentage of women is overwhelming. And the Lilith event is now seen as a major event of women performing on the same stage.
While Olivia Records, as of 1990, has been transformed into Olivia Cruises, the history has been recorded and the music continues to be distributed.
You throw the pebble in the water and you see it drop in and then you see the ripple effects, but you may never know where that pebble, where the original pebble started, but all of a sudden it grows and it grows.
Hi, I'm Katie Lang. You're watching In the Life.
Still to come on In the Life.
Iowa's Foster Parents of the Year. And the winner is Gay Awards, Flash, and Cash for a good cause. But first,
freedom of religion, a fundamental right of all Americans under the Constitution. But gay men and lesbians have been limited in their participation in many aspects of religious life, like marriage and the ministry. Still, increasingly, gay believers are expressing their religious devotion and demanding recognition by mainstream churches. In our next segment, we meet two United Methodist ministers working to make their parishes open and welcoming to all worshipers. We begin here in Nebraska, where the Reverend Jimmy Creech elicited outcries of hellfire and damnation last year when he performed a commitment ceremony between two women.
First United Methodist Church in Omaha, Nebraska. It was here that Reverend Jimmy Creech first drew national attention by breaking a rule.
In July of 1997, I was asked to do a covenant ceremony for two women. I agreed to do so, and then in September did the covenant ceremony.
A ceremony which, as of 1996, had been forbidden by the church's social principles, principles that are voted on every 4 years by the United Methodist hierarchy.
In 96, there was added to our social principles a prohibition of clergy celebrating, to use the language of the discipline, homosexual unions. And it was on the basis of that prohibition that charges were brought against me and I was taken to trial.
A church trial with a bishop presiding and a jury made up of 13 clergy members. It was the first time a pastor was tried for conducting a same-sex union.
There is administrative law and there are social principles. And the principles are really guidelines. Some people have wanted to treat them as if they are law, but they're not. And I conscientiously acted in conflict with them because I believe that the social principles are unjust and discriminatory in this particular case.
Acting in conflict with the principal forced the jury to vote on whether Reverend Creech had disobeyed the order and discipline of the United Methodist Church. The jury's response? 5 voted no and 8 voted yes, but they needed 9 to convict, so he was acquitted.
What was, I think, significant about it is I was not certainly the first ever to do a covenant ceremony. I have celebrated more than a dozen covenant ceremonies since 1990. But it's the first since the legislation was passed in 1996. And it was the first one that was made public.
It is, in fact, these very public statements and actions that has drawn so much criticism, both before and after the trial.
Performing a covenant ceremony in a church is tantamount to sanctioning the behavior. he is no good. He should be derobed and clear out of the Methodist system and out of everyone's system as far as I'm concerned.
On this, on the issue of gays and lesbians in society or in the church, we are divided. What I simply did was to take an action that caused people to address that division and decide whether they could still remain together while divided on this issue, or whether they had to separate.
And many have chosen to separate.
There has been significant disagreement within the congregation and withdrawal of members. We really are hurting because of the loss.
Beyond the loss of many in Creech's congregation, the United Methodist hierarchy and many of its members have recently reaffirmed their commitment against gay unions.
There's a wonderful African statement or saying that says, the dying man cries the loudest just before death. I think those who are wanting to resist the acceptance of gay men and lesbians into the Christian community are resisting loudest and hardest right now and crying the loudest.
Yet the voices of dissent, however loud, have not overpowered the strong show of support that has also emerged. The day we arrived, First United and many supporters were celebrating and embracing diversity.
We're very much in support of Jimmy Creech and his efforts to be inclusive, particularly with the gays and lesbians.
His life, his very career was placed on the line, and he stood up for me as a gay guy.
We've had a lot of great ministers, but I think he's been the greatest. I really do.
Something special is happening here. This congregation is living out its faith in a very bold and courageous way to say that we are open to lesbians and gay men, bisexual, transgender persons. There has been so much oppression and abuse of this part of our community that I believe the church cannot just quietly say, we welcome you. We must shout it out.
As First United and the Reverend Creech struggle through this period of transition, perhaps they can draw strength from another United Methodist Church that has been a strong and bold witness to diversity for 35 years.
This is San Francisco. This is Cecil Williams. This is GLAAD Church. We're one of the most integrated churches in America, probably the most diverse church. So when you look at us, you look at diversity not only in sexuality, or diversity not only in race, but diversity in ideology. So this is it's a strange place, but it's the church.
It is Reverend Williams' interpretation of what a church is that has propelled GLAAD's vision.
First of all, the church is the people, not the building. Secondly, the church, it seems to me, must have some sense of belonging, a sense of being with each other, no matter how difficult things may be. No matter whatever they have to face, they do it because the church must lead, always lead. That means that the church must take risks.
Now, my brothers and my sisters.
And with the support of his bishop, Reverend Williams has successfully taken risks. During his tenure, GLAAD's congregation has grown from 40 to nearly 9,000 parishioners. It is one of the leading social service providers in California, and certainly a leading advocate on many social issues, including gay unions.
We've had same-sex couples coming together in commitments or marriages or whatever you want to call them for some 34, 35 years here at GLAAD.
No matter what their sexual orientation of the people who grow there, they grow there because they are considered human beings.
It hurts very deeply for people to be disrespected, humiliated, and denigrated, to be put down. And that's what the church is doing. What it in fact says to homosexuals, you don't exist unless you get like us. And I don't understand why we're so frightened about people being gay, or people. I guess, you know, the real thing was people also felt threatened and frightened by black folks coming into the fold. We have messed up too much, haven't we?
Finally, more important than United Methodist policy to these two heterosexual ministers are the teachings of Christ.
You know, it's a strange thing about it. I don't see anything that Jesus did. At any given point, did Jesus, I'm saying, exclude anybody?
So if I'm to be a pastor, and if I'm to follow Jesus in that kind of example, then I cannot discriminate against anyone. I cannot tell anyone that because of who they are, God's love is not available to them.
Perhaps the starkest example of the division of the United Methodist Church over the issue of homosexuality is this. While Reverend Williams continues to attract members because of his vision, Reverend Jimmy Creech, for that same vision, was recently fired.
In the fine American tradition of more is better, awards ceremonies have become a cultural staple. From the Tonys to the Oscars to the Grammys, every year Americans tune in, celebrities turn up, and millions of dollars pour in as awards are bestowed for accomplishments in film, stage, music, whatever. In our next segment, special guest correspondent Kay Clinton shows us how the gay community has taken these ceremonies and made them their own.
The GLAAD nominees for Out Recording are...
And the nominees for Outstanding Achievement in Movies and Television are...
The GLAAD are...
It's totally about winning.
It's better to be nominated. It's great to win.
I wish it could have been bigger and on ABC and NBC and all that stuff that people know, but since they have every other award show on there and we have to watch them, why can't they watch us?
In many ways, of course, they've been watching gays and lesbians for years, for we've been choreographing, directing, editing, producing these mega award shows. And boy, am I familiar with the awards phenomena. You know, I've hosted more award shows than Pfizer has those little blue pills.
It's sort of like a gay Lollapalooza.
Every nominee tonight is considered a winner, man. Thank you.
Any discussion of awards must begin with the Oscars, often called the Gay Super Bowl.
The Oscars have appeal to gay people because it's Hollywood, it's movies, it's fantasy, it's glamour, it's escape, it's all those things that that traditionally we practice.
Bruce Vilan should know. He's been writing for the Oscars for 9 years.
And I've written every one of those shows. I'm down to the American Bulimia Awards. I have nothing left. I've done them all.
Welcome to the 70th Annual Academy Awards.
So many gay people live their lives in not the closet, but behind a mask, and they get to watch other people dropping their mask on that show.
Since the gay community surely gives televised award ceremonies a few more points than the Nielsens, it's only logical that they adopt a series of awards events for themselves. Gays and lesbians are taking the concept of dropping the mask a step further by recognizing those that challenge homophobia through their artistry and their openness. Awards given by GLAAD, the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, recognize individuals and organizations across many media for their work in presenting accurate information about the gay community. But besides honoring work, they also have a practical function, money. The GLAAD Awards, held on both coasts, is a primary source of funding for the organization, raising over $1.4 million.
And the GLAAD Media Award goes to Yep, I'm Gay. Time Magazine's cover story.
I think it's important that the people see that somebody got an award for a positive portrayal of a gay person. So I think that's the impact it has. I don't think it changes lives. It's a relatively inexpensive way to gather a whole bunch of stars in a room and show them off, as long as it keeps attracting an audience. They'll keep doing them. I mean, they're really what Daniel Boorstin called pseudo-events.
Somewhere
Pseudo or not, these awards given by the gay community are as much about courage as anything else. The courage to be out, or even the courage to be supportive of gay causes in a world often hostile to the idea of gay identity.
The gay community has been so accepting of me and my career that it's a small way for me to be able to give back.
This was just something that just seemed very natural to me and made sense to me to support. So I owe
not a notion. At one time, a way to refer to a gay man was to say, he's very musical. Well, today, being musical and out is cause for yet another award ceremony, the Gay and Lesbian American Music Awards. At this event, you might find a few performers you didn't see at the Grammys or the Country Music Awards.
The nominees for best use of naked male buttocks on an album cover.
Score with award shows. I know how it works. We watch the Academy Awards. Billy Crystal comes out. We're like, Billy, we love you. You're so funny. About an hour into it, like, get the hell off. Who won?
Oh, yes, I'm so sorry. There are no losers here tonight. Only people who have failed to win.
I don't know, I just kind of hope that it's like early Soul Train years, you know what I mean? Like kind of a minority award show that becomes this very traditional, very important award show.
So I accept this beautiful award on behalf of every drag queen or transgender or transsexual or Lion King or who's ever slipped on a wig and a pair of high heels. I accept this award on your behalf. Thank you, and I love you. Thank you.
So what about the future for awards events in the gay community?
I don't think that we're going to see the diminishing of the importance of awards generally in American culture, because we're just too win-oriented.
The winner is, the f***ing Grammy goes to the Indigo Girl.
Awards may have become commonplace, but in 1996, two Iowa men were given an award that was rather uncommon for a gay couple. Gare Bridges and Ron Travis were named Foster Parents of the Year in that state, and it was the first time a gay couple were given such an honor. For our final segment, we take you to America's heartland, Eldora, Iowa, to meet these incredible parents and a few of their kids. In the small town of Eldora, Iowa, Ron Travis and Gare Bridges have opened their home to 18 foster children over the last 10 years.
Ron and I have been together for 23 years. 10 years ago, I thought it'd be kind of nice if we had a family, so I contacted the Department of Human Services, which is out of the state of Iowa, and they thought, instead of adopting, that maybe we should become foster parents first, and then from there, see how we did with the kids and adopt.
He wanted the family initially, mm-hmm. And at that time they didn't know we were a couple. And after he started going down the road for foster care, going to sign up for the training, that's when they said, well, all the adults in the house have to be involved. And so that's how I got involved.
Never intended on adopting a baby. Mm-hmm. Always was the thought, you know, maybe we can make a difference in somebody's life, maybe change it around for them. Gary was our first foster kid. He came to us when he was 15. Came from a disrupted family. Juvenile court system was in control of him. And they called us at 5 o'clock, and at 6 o'clock we had a kid. Very scared kid.
I didn't even know I was gonna be gone until that day. I was told, you're gonna get your stuff together, you're going to a foster home. So just like that day I was gone. So I had no idea. As I said, my world was just turned right upside down. I didn't know what to think, and then I heard about their lifestyle, and then I was kind of afraid, and you know, the stereotype, the images were coming to my mind and stuff, and until I finally met them after a week. It's great. They were there for me. I could trust them, and I consider them my dads, you know, my two dads.
After Gary, being foster parents became a way of life.
All the kids that are in our home, understand that we're a gay family. Some of them we have not told immediately. We wanted them to get used to us first, know that we are good people, and then there's nothing wrong with, you know, with being here. Some we've had to tell right away just because of the school situation, depending on when they come into school. Obviously, that the kids in school know that we're gay, and we didn't want it to be brought out to them at school.
I met Ron and Gary because I was a runaway from home, and my mom just couldn't deal with it anymore, so I got put in involuntary foster care here.
Like many kids who end up in foster care, Andre would run away when his home situation became intolerable.
I spent nights underneath viaducts in my hometown, and over friends' houses, underneath friends' porches, and people I didn't even know in their garage. Living here with Ron and Gare, it was a very safe environment. I didn't have to go through any abuse. Unlike living with my mom, I had to go through mental and physical abuse. And she couldn't deal with it anymore. And that's what caused me to go on run.
We keep referring back to consistency in our home. These kids come from backgrounds where it doesn't matter how late they're out at night. Their meals are very haphazard, usually sitting in front of a TV, not full meals. And where our consistency is, we sit down every night at the dining room table, and for the most part, for most of the kids here, that's a big change for them, you know, to actually sit down at the table and you pass the food around and you wait till everybody is served and then you eat. If the phone rings during the meal, we don't answer it. We don't have the TV on. There's no interruptions.
4 years ago, I was in a youth shelter in Fort Dodge, and I ended up here because my home environment was not acceptable. Ron and Gare were more like friends because they treated me as a peer instead of as a child and allowed me to mature, like catch up to where I was.
While being foster parents means everything in the world to Ron and Gare, they also knew that someday they wanted to adopt a child. After an almost successful attempt of adopting a two-year-old named George, the Department of Human Services one day called them with the right child, named Eddie.
DHS kind of waited until they found a child that they knew that all rights had been terminated, all the court proceedings had been taken care of, and they called us up and said, hey, we've got a little boy here, would you guys be interested? And so we went to meet him and fell in love with him right away and brought him home, and 6 months later we adopted him. He came to us at 2 and he was not speaking at that time. He was still in the bottle and was still in diapers.
Not on solid foods. So that was a new experience.
Given Ron and Gare's dedication as foster parents, many in Eldora were not surprised when they won Iowa Foster and Adoptive Parents of the Year Award in 1996. The surprise was, who made the nomination?
I nominated Ron and Gare for Foster Family of the Year for the fact that they're the first people that's ever respected me, and they actually took care of me instead of just making me do things of my own. And I appreciated it, and I thought they deserved it. And so happens, after I moved out and everything, they got elected for it.
This was the first time the award was given where the nomination came from a foster child and not from a foster parent or a social worker. So it really made the award really special for us.
From all of us at In the Life, thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.
Somewhere over the rainbow, way up high, there's a land that I heard of once in a lullaby.
Let's all stroll together like the prince did crow. When you're stroking mama, mama's stroking you.
You're living in America at the end of the millennium. You're living in America where it's like the twilight.
In the Life is funded in part by the H. Van Amerengen Foundation. Additional support provided by the Gill Foundation, the Michael Palm Foundation, the Snowden Foundation, Richard M. and Peggy Danziger, Jeffrey B. Soriff, the Mitchell Gold Company, in the hopes of eliminating all types of fear and prejudice, the Nebraska AIDS Project, and In the Life members like you.